2020. On behalf of the Center for Capital Markets and Risk Management, IIM Bangalore, I, Anvesha Sinha, welcome you all. Our speaker for this evening is Mr. Ravi Varanasi, Chief Business Officer, National Stock Exchange. Mr. Ravi Varanasi has an experience of more than 30 years in the financial markets. He has been serving as the Chief Business Development in the National Stock Exchange of India for more than 25 years now. Previously, he has worked as Senior Deputy Manager, ING Visya Bank, and as Assistant Manager in State Bank of India. We welcome you, sir. The topic for his webinar is Evolution of Market Infrastructure in Securities Market. The webinar will be followed by a Q&A session where everyone can ask their relevant questions. The chat window will be kept off till then. Thank you. So we can begin now, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, your audio has been switched off, sir. So we can begin with the presentation now, sir.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks, IIM Bangalore, for inviting me for this chat with the participants. This is the World Investor Week, which we are celebrating along with the International Association for Securities Regulators. In India, SEBI is leading the initiative. We are having a series of activities during this week. Starting from yesterday, when we had a closing bell with our regulator. So essentially, the idea is to spread the message of investor awareness. That has been the focus of this particular initiative. So we have close to about 500 odd webinars planned during this week. We are doing a quiz for investors. Close to about 50,000 registrations have already happened. We are doing a specific program for women entrepreneurs calling it Be Your Own Lakshmi. Idea is to try and share in investment philosophies, experience with successful investment ideas from people who are who have been in this field with other women. So that is one area which we are looking at. So this particular, today's chat is essentially around the market infrastructure which has evolved over the last 25 years. All of you are aware, essentially, NSE has come into existence sometime in 94. In 92, SEBI was set up. So most of the reforms in Indian markets have happened over the last about 25 to 30 years. So there has been a significant change. India has pre NSE and SEBI versus post, the current situation, there's a sea change. India was one of the, possibly the laggards at that point of time in terms of market infrastructure and the practices. That has changed dramatically. We are one of the largest and one of the best platforms in the world right now. So before NSE came into existence, there were regional stock exchanges. Almost every state had their own stock exchange. And there was tremendous amount of fragmentation of liquidity. So that has led to a series of issues. So NSE has implemented a nationwide electronic market. We have used telecommunication infrastructure in such a way that we're able to take trading to the doorsteps of each and every investor and wherever they are. So we've used satellite-based technology at that point of time. In India, the telecommunication network was very bad. So we had to necessarily use satellite communication to take the trading to across the country. So that is one of the first things which we have done. So essentially, trading has moved from the pit to the computer screens almost instantaneously in India. Way ahead of some of the advanced markets continue to have a pit till about 10 years back also. So we had become a completely electronic market almost overnight when NSE came into existence. The other innovation which has happened at that point of time, again, that was the first in the world, among the first in the world. Most exchanges at that point of time were owned by the brokerages. So we have set up NSE as a completely demutualized exchange. That is, there has been a segregation of roles. Trading members, the brokerages had the trading rights. They are not the owners. Owners were essentially, NSE when it was set up, the owners were essentially government-controlled financial institutions, mostly banks, development financial institutions, LIC, IDBI. Most of the banks, ICICI, State Bank of India. So all those financial institutions came together to set up NSE. And the management was completely professional. So there has been a clear segregation of ownership, management, and trading rights. So that has, the idea was to try and eliminate the conflict of interest with a demutualized structure. So that has literally changed the way markets operate. And now demutualization is the de rigueur, and things are changing again. The market structure is never constant. Internationally, a lot of exchanges have listed. In India also, we have exchanges which have listed. NSE also will list in due course. So essentially, but the initial spurt to demutualization in a way started with a few exchanges. NSE was one of those few exchanges. The lack of transparency has been completely eliminated, because the moment you have everything is available on the computer screen, data was available, and people can actually look at what was happening in the market. Nothing was hidden from the investor. So to that extent, things have dramatically changed overnight. We moved, then we have helped in setting up the first depository in India. That has literally changed again from paper-based settlement to electronic settlement. And again, India was one of the first few countries which have gone in for complete demutualization. Again, there was pre-NSE settlement cycles were long, and there was no certainty of settlement. So people used to trade for almost 30 days, and then settlement used to happen as and when everybody paid in. So it was a completely uncertain kind of a scenario. When we came in with a weekly settlement. We said people can trade from Wednesday to Tuesday, and settlement happens on next Monday and Wednesday. So we tried to bring in a rhythm to the settlement. Subsequently, we moved to daily settlement, and first T plus, right now we are at T plus 2. There has been a talk of T plus from the regulators, but T plus 2 is the de rigueur in the world. Almost every exchange, all modern exchanges are at T plus 2 level. And this kind of serves, and international investors are used to a T plus 2 kind of a settlement. Purely from the exchange angle, T plus 1 also is possible, but the ecosystem needs to fall in place. So we brought in the counterparty. I mean, essentially earlier, before NSE came in, when the settlement was never certain. So if one of the brokers did not bring the money, the settlement used to be held up. So we brought what we call a central counterparty as a counterparty for every single settlement. So essentially, irrespective of whether there's a broker failure or not, our clearing corporation steps in for as the counterparty for all the settlements and ensures that settlements are happening on clockwork precision. So in our 25-year history, there was never a delay in settling a particular trade in exchange. The biggest thing which has again brought in, which I'll possibly allude to as we go forward, the risk management practices have been brought in by exchange. We have brought in online real-time risk management, the monitoring of client positions, margining. India is again is one of the first countries to adopt online real-time margining at the client level. Most exchanges in the world tend to margin at a gross level, I mean, essentially at the broker level. So they net off the positions of various clients of a particular broker and collect the margin at the broker level, which is netted against various clients. Supposing a client A buys from a broker and the same broker's client B sells, at the broker level, there's no margin because A and B netted out. But whereas in India, right from the beginning, we collected the margin from A as well as B. So the risk management practices have been very stringent, online, real time. And if there is no margin, the brokerage is not allowed to further trade. So all these changes which we have brought in over the period have dramatically changed the face of broking industry. And intermediation costs have dropped dramatically. I remember in 90s, intermediation costs for somebody who is trading from upcountry location could be as high as 10%. Now, broking costs have dramatically come down. There are all kinds of schemes which are available. I mean, the exact numbers, most of you are aware. The broking industry has moved to a scenario where the intermediation costs have been kind of taken off the list of worries for the investor as such. When we started again, we started initially as a debt market initially, but equities have taken over. It was for quite some time, NSE has been essentially an equity exchange with a fair amount of focus on other areas. But over a period, derivatives have come in, equity derivatives in early 2000. And India has now become one of the largest, NSE is the largest derivatives exchange in the world by number of contracts traded. Again, last year, we were the largest exchange in the world. Again, over a period, we started introducing various asset classes. As I said, equity derivatives came in early 2000s, and then subsequently we brought in currency derivatives. Then came ETFs, REITs, InVITs, commodity derivatives, fixed income derivatives over a period of time. And in fact, the market, now we are able to offer a unified marketplace across asset classes for investors. That has been made possible by the merger of Forward Markets Commission with SEBI. Now we have a single regulator for all the financial markets in the form of SEBI. SEBI kind of regulates all the asset classes. So that has really brought in a significant amount of uniformity to the regulatory environment, as well as a single platform where investors can access multiple asset classes based on their risk profile. So that kind of really changed dramatically the way exchanges operate, and brokerages are able to offer multiple asset classes, right from government securities to highly complex instruments also. All said and done, India derivatives markets are a fairly plain vanilla derivatives are only allowed in India. So we offer futures and options. The complex derivatives are not allowed. But there are risk management tools which have been provided for the investors in the marketplace. I kind of would want to spend a little bit of time on the unique market structure of India, particularly if we look at most advanced markets. The markets are essentially institutional. So US, if you take close to 70% of the market is institutional trade. Just about 30% is so-called retail. Whereas India has been consistently about 50% of the market is retail. And in the last the COVID period particularly, the number has gone to close to 60%. So India has again made purely from the market structure perspective, a highly individualized retail market. And that has made us to evolve a market structure which is different from other markets. So India is an identity market. So any client who wants to trade on the exchange platform first needs to register through a brokerage with the exchange and provide PAN and other details. So every single client's identity is known upfront before the client starts trading. I talked about online real-time margining. That's a unique feature. When we started, obviously, that was a unique feature. Now, quite a few exchanges do online real-time market margining. But again, as I said, our margining is gross at the client level. So each client has to pay margin, whereas some international markets tend to have netting kind of scenario. So a lot of markets offer omnibus kind of a structure where client identity is not available upfront. It's all merged and comes through the brokerage to the market and the exchange platform. So the structure essentially has been devised in such a way that we are able to protect the interests of the investors. That has been the focus of the market structure evolution in India. Particularly SEBI has been very, very particular in ensuring that we are able to bring in a market structure which takes care of the investor interests. There has been exceedingly close oversight on the way markets function. There are surveillance, market quality parameters which we build, which we monitor the market activity on a continuous basis throughout the market timing. And SEBI also does their own market surveillance function. And there are a series of alerts which get generated and acted upon. The idea is to try and provide a marketplace which is safe, which is robust, and which is available for all investors. So that has been the focus. Technology has always been the backbone of NSE right from the beginning. As I mentioned earlier, we have started with a state-of-the-art satellite-based telecommunication network to get over the deficiencies of telecommunication network at that point of time in India. We have continued to invest in technology throughout. Right now, we offer multimodal network across the country. People can connect using lease lines, connect using internet, they can connect using Wi-Fi, they can connect using VSAT. So we kind of left a significant bouquet of services for investors in terms of their ability to connect to their broker and brokers to connect to us. And we have established a completely resilient network with multiple redundancies at the network layer itself. People can connect, and then we kind of ensure that we are able to carry the messages through multiple channels without affecting the efficacy of those messages. And obviously, some of the large institutional investors, high frequency traders, require a low latency kind of a scenario where their ability to get the market data and react to that and place orders is critical. So we offer an exceedingly low latency market infrastructure with high throughput. We have the capability. Each of our market machines can accept close to about 200,000 order messages every second. We run close to about 12 of them. So essentially, we can accept 2.5 million order messages every second. So it's a huge infrastructure which we have created. Idea is to ensure that whatever happens, even if there is a significant volatility when investors place orders through their brokerages, our systems will be able to take those messages and work on them and then give trade confirmations in exceedingly times which are in microseconds, not in milliseconds. So our latencies are measured in microseconds. That is about a millionth of a second. So essentially, the infrastructure has been built in such a way that we are able to provide the best possible trading infrastructure for our trading members, who in turn service the clients. While the secondary market infrastructure is evolving, there has been a significant, build on the primary market side also. SEBI has been very, very particular in laying down the regulations and rules and regulations in such a way that primary market infrastructure kept pace with the secondary market infrastructure. So primary market infrastructure, particularly the IPOs and all, earlier there were a series of issues in the way IPOs were being handled. Over a period, SEBI has brought in various reforms in that area where the funds don't leave investors' account and entire allocation happens, and subsequently only on successful allocation, funds leave the investor's account. So the issues of refund orders and everything has been eliminated. So there has been a significant change in the way IPOs are handled. The times have been collapsed. The time between the IPO and the listing has been collapsed to 6 days, and it can further be brought down to just 2 days. There are a series of reforms which are possible. NSE and SEBI have been working on a variety of models which will help investors to access markets as easily as possible. In fact, the market access has been an issue which SEBI has paid significant attention. The entire registration process is now completely digital. In fact, some of you would, I don't know how many of you would know, during the COVID times, obviously, the life has changed dramatically. But our brokerages have been able to continue to offer services without any difficulty using digital media. And the most heartening feature is close to 50 lakh new investors have come into the market fold during this COVID times. So in the last, that's from March till now, close to more than 50 lakh investors have come into the market fold, and everything done digitally. The entire client onboarding process has been done digitally by our brokerages. That's been a fantastic achievement. And the ecosystem around investors has grown dramatically. I'll talk about this in a little bit. While the equity markets have grown and have seen and usually catch the eye, there has been a huge development, huge set of developments on the bond front. On the corporate bonds, close to 10 lakh crores is being raised from the market for the last 2 years. And this is a huge achievement. With the banking system under strain because of various issues, and banking system is not actually designed to offer long-term financing to corporates. Long-term financing has to come from the bond markets. Unfortunately, in India, the bond markets have not been very, very well developed. But we have seen a change in the last few years. And there has been a significant uptick in terms of number of bonds which are being issued and money which is being raised from the markets. There have been changes in the way even RBI auctions the government securities. Earlier, retail investors buying government securities was almost impossible. For the last couple of year and a half, all investors can actually participate in weekly auctions by Reserve Bank of India through any of your brokers. It's a non-competitive bidding platform has been opened by Reserve Bank of India. NSE and NSE brokerages offer the non-competitive bidding. Any investor can just walk to their brokerage and participate in the weekly auctions which Reserve Bank of India does for government securities. Obviously, instead of going to a bank, you can just buy government securities and you'll get a decent enough return without going through. Somebody who is completely risk averse possibly can go to government securities. Somebody who has a little bit of risk appetite can possibly look at corporate bonds. People who have further risk appetite, equity markets are available. People have understanding of the equity markets and have the capacity to take further risk. Derivative markets are available, equity, commodities, currency. So the entire asset classes are available. It is a huge set of offering which is there. As I mentioned, clearing corporation is one of the soundest clearing corporations. We have said it's 100% subsidiary of the exchange. It is rated consistently by the CRISIL as AAA, and it's an in-house NSE operation. We do online real-time client margining, and variety of services are provided by the clearing corporation. The basic purpose of clearing corporation is to provide innovation. Basically, it's the counterparty for every single trade. So instead of you trading, when you're trading, you're not trading with somebody else. You're trading with the clearing corporation. So settlement guarantee, there's a huge settlement guarantee fund which has been set up to ensure that settlements go through smoothly without any difficulty. I talked about market quality earlier. Market quality is critical. So the quality of market assurance is what allows investors to come into the market and remain in the market. We do online real-time market surveillance. We have a variety of tools which we use to try and make things, in a way, control the market and ensure that the market is working as per the regulations prescribed by SEBI. While we have created the market infrastructure, which is world-class, we have seen our broking industry responding to that. They have grown from a fairly primitive stage in early 1990s to one of the, so it's now a sophisticated broking industry which we have here. There's huge amount of technology adoption which has happened in the broking industry, initially by force, because we have gone to electronic platforms straight away. So broking industry had to learn, and we have seen quick adoption from the broking industry. One more change which we have brought in when we came in 94, 95 was till the time the broking was a closed club. So essentially, if one broker is there, they used to have a broking card from an exchange, and that is essentially hereditary, and the card used to have a value. And the people can limited number of seats available in exchange. So we've changed all that. We said all professionals who have basic professional qualification, financial professional qualification, can become brokers by depositing X amount of money. So we just opened up the gates of broking, and most of the top-notch brokerages you see today were the product of that opening up of broking industry by NSE at that point of time. And most of the big, large broking groups have come along with NSE around that time and have built sophisticated infrastructure, nationwide networks, and electronic front ends. Large number of facilities they are able to provide. Off late, particularly with fintechs doing tremendous amount of innovation. There's huge amount of information always available. That information is being now in a way digested and presented for investors by way of information modules. Our tools, decision support systems are being provided. There is a significant evolution of broking industry. And almost any of you, I don't know how many of you actually invest using broking industry's front ends. All of them offer mobile-based trading, internet-based trading. In fact, we have seen in the last about internet-based trading is around a dozen years. Mobile is a relatively recent phenomenon. Between mobile and internet, now we get close to about a third of our total trading activity in cash market comes through these two modes. So that means investors are taking control of the order flow. Earlier, usually investors either used to call a broker and place an order, or go to broker's office, sit there and place an order. And now that has changed dramatically. Almost all brokerages offer mobile-based front ends, internet-based front ends. All investors can see what they want to see on their mobile or internet front end, and then look at the information, take a decision, place an order, and kind of monitor the order's life cycle through from the time they place the order till the time it gets executed and through the settlement. So there is a tremendous amount of change which has come in the last couple of decades, and the pace of change has dramatically increased in the last 3 to 4 years, and particularly in COVID times, that has really, really taken a degree of the speed at which things are happening now is quite phenomenal. And our sense is, as we go forward, these fintech innovations will keep coming in, which will make understanding of market data, understanding of market information, a lot more easier for investors. And there are tools which are coming in, which will help investors to take those decisions and then possibly execute their investment decisions far more efficiently, all sitting before a computer or using a mobile phone. We believe there is a huge possibilities as we go forward. While we have achieved quite a bit in the last 2.5 decades, the penetration levels in India are still very, very low. All said and done, we have about 3.5 crore investors who are registered on exchange platform. In a population of 130 crores, that number is very, very small. Even if you take the mutual fund, people who are investing through the mutual funds, because finally mutual funds invest in equity markets. Equity markets are debt markets. So essentially, even if they take an indirect route and come to the market through either mutual fund schemes or ETFs, that number also is not going to take the total, possibly that number takes the 3.5 crores to about 5 crores. Again, there is huge potential out there. In fact, one of the heartening features again is of the 50 lakh investors who have come into the fold in the last 9 months period, close to about a third of them are coming from tier 2, tier 3 cities and towns, villages. So we believe the penetration is increasing, but there's a lot more which has to happen. That's where some of the efforts which we are doing in terms of investor awareness, education, building tools, helping the fintechs to bring tools which make sense to the investors. All these efforts are in the direction of ensuring that we are able to take markets to investors. Not just equity markets. As I mentioned, there is a significant potential for risk-averse investors to come into corporate bonds, government securities, even municipal bonds, and all kinds of bonds which are available. There is a market out there which will help investors to manage their risk far more efficiently. And we believe we, as a market infrastructure institution, we have an obligation to ensure that we are providing state of the art infrastructure, and the skilling is critical. We keep doing lots of programs. In fact, our website is a storehouse of information. And most of you can visit there. We are in the process of actually augmenting the website and modernizing the website. In the next, we have actually moved to a new website in the last 2 months. We are adding a lot more features to the website, which help investors to manage the information efficiently and take decisions. While the brokerages are providing most of the services, we believe we have a responsibility and duty to provide the services to our investors. As I mentioned, again, India is commodity derivatives. I'll just touch upon a little bit before talk about a few more things and close, so that we can take any questions if you have. India is one of the largest producer and our consumer of almost every single commodity. Take it, be it gold, be it agriculture, metals, take anything. We are one of the largest either a producer or a consumer. Unfortunately, none of these commodities are priced out of India. Even commodities where we are the number one or number two consumer. Gold, obviously, we are the number two consumer in the world. But gold price is set internationally. We are the price takers than price setters. That's because the markets are fragmented. And while we have commodity derivatives market exchanges for the last about 15 years, we have gotten to commodity derivatives just about a year and a half back. We are trying to build India-focused products. And we are trying to build India standards for all the commodities so that India becomes the price setter rather than price taker as we have been in the last couple of years. I just wanted to touch upon a couple of areas before I close. There is generally a sense that stock markets are for speculators and derivatives are weapons of mass destruction and stuff like that. There are very, very large number of myths around stock markets. Stock markets are perform various functions. Speculation possibly is one of them, but the market and the fundraising is the core function of stock exchanges. As I mentioned, close to 10 lakh crores get funded from stock markets. In fact, in the last 2 years, the amount of money which is raised, the debt capital which is raised through stock markets is more than the net bank credit. So there's a huge amount of activity which is going out there. And our focus is to try and provide a series of services which help investors to participate and benefit from the equity premium. So the empirical studies, not only in India, empirical studies across the world have proven that the equity premium tends to be close to about 600 to 700 basis points compared to fixed income return. So in the long run, people who have invested in equities for a longer time horizon tend to benefit. There are instruments available in the market which help you to plan your investment over a long period of time. There are instruments which are available which help investors who are qualified, who understands the market, to take risks and then possibly participate in the market far more aggressively. So it is up to the investors to decide where they want to stand. It is not everybody's cup of tea to participate in derivatives market. And there are a significant amount of boundaries which have been created by SEBI. Not everybody can participate in derivatives market. There is a risk disclosure document which is required, the basic KYC, which is far more stringent for derivatives. In fact, just about a tenth of investors participate in derivatives. A lot of people think that every retail investor is participating in derivative, which is not true. Just about 10th of the total investor number actually participate in the derivatives market. Derivatives while primary markets are important for capital raising, secondary markets are important for ensuring that the risk capital is efficiently allocated. Derivatives markets, which are tertiary markets, are required to ensure that the risk is laid off to people who have the capacity to take the risk. So all three markets have to grow together. In fact, if we look at the last 10 years period, the cash market, which is our equity market, and the derivatives market have grown almost alongside. The rate of growth is exactly the same for cash market as well as derivatives market. There is understanding problem in the market where they think derivatives markets have grown significantly faster than cash markets, which is not correct. But for a market to be safe and market which provides the entire range of services, you need to have primary markets, secondary markets and tertiary markets all have to have liquidity that actually feeds in. A liquid market is the best protection for investor. A derivatives market induces liquidity into the cash market that helps investors to actually manage their risk far more efficiently. So that's essentially what I wanted to say on equity market evolution and the derivatives market evolution and overall the market evolution, the market microstructure over the last couple of decades of our existence. NSE is just about 25 year old. We have been lucky to be there when the markets are changing. In a way, we have helped change the market along with SEBI. A lot of changes have been brought in when NSE and SEBI have come into existence in early part of 90s. And possibly that has helped change the market structure in India. And as I mentioned, market structure in India is different from some of the international market structures. But we need to build a market structure which is good for our country, which is good for our economy. And that's what we possibly have done. And we are comparable to the best in the world. As I mentioned, NSE is the largest derivatives exchange in the world now. and we have multiple offerings, and not just in India. Now we have our wholly owned subsidiary sitting out of International Financial Services in center in GIFT City, again offering services to international investors out of GIFT City. So there are a series of offerings which are there. Our idea is to build world-class institution and world-class practices, best practices for investors, and ensure that investors receive the kind of services they have the right to receive, and information, education, tools which will make the investing a far more safe endeavor for investors. That's where we are. Thank you very much for patient hearing. If you have any questions, I'm more than happy to take those questions.
Thank you, sir. Sir, we have a question from Mr. Rahul Rao. What happens to a retail investor in the corporate bond market if the issuing firm defaults?
There is a question which has come. What happens to a retail investor in corporate bond market if the issuing firm defaults? Well, any investment in the market has a risk involved. No market investment is risk-free, other than possibly government securities, government of India securities. Corporate bond, if there is a failure of issuer, the default of the issuer, then same as equities. In case of a default of a firm, there is the risk which is there with equities will be there, but the risk is slightly different, because if it's a debenture, these bonds are issued against specific assets. If those assets are available, those assets precedences which are available for investors. But a failure is a failure. So investors need to be very careful in choosing bonds where they're investing. Again, credit rating is a pointer. Risk-averse investors need to ensure that they're getting into highly rated bonds. Investors who have a higher appetite for risk can get into lower rated bonds. They'll give higher return, but the risk is commensurate. So essentially, there's no free lunch in markets. Risk is commensurate with the return which you are expecting.
Sir, the second question is from Mr. Tanmay Agarwal.
Somebody has asked any tips for those who are entering stock markets for the first time. You need to ensure that you are choosing your broker wisely. Brokerage which has the capacity, who understands you, and you understand the broker. You need to, while the brokerage needs to know their client, know your client is what the brokerage does. You need to know your brokerage. So look at the brokerage and their track record, their services, and open the account and ensure that you follow the regulations properly. And you are not expected to leave money with the brokerage. There are very, very strict rules which have been put in place. You need to ensure that you don't leave money with the brokerage unless you are required to actually pay a margin or pay the price of a security which you're buying. Don't leave the securities and the funds with the brokerage unless they are required for the specific purpose of your active investing or active trading. Other than that, the rules are very clearly there, and investing has become purely from a technical point of view. Investing has become very, very simple. Everything is available nowadays on the internet. But please understand your risk appetite, your ability, how much of risk capital you can put in, what is your goal in investment, your age, your future plans, how much of risk you are willing to take. For investors, particularly first-time investors, it makes a lot of sense to get into index funds. Their ETFs, exchange-traded funds, are nothing but passive index funds. They're available, they trade on the exchange. Their annual maintenance charges are exceedingly small. Even for a mutual fund, normal mutual fund, you might have an AMC of close to about 1.5% to 2% to 2.5%, whereas ETFs come at 8 basis points, 10 basis points. The cost is very, very low, and cost of acquisition is very low. And they perform, basically you get the market return. Whatever is the Nifty return, you get the Nifty return. If you invest in an ETF which is following Nifty, you get the Nifty return. But a long-term investor who doesn't understand, doesn't have time, or doesn't have the appetite to go through a fair amount of literature, it makes a lot of sense to invest in passive investment vehicles like ETFs and passive index funds. But just ensure that your money is safe. That's far more important. If you have knowledge and if you have the appetite, if you have the understanding, then you can proceed to further products like individual securities. You need to understand the risk profile of the security and then invest in that, both equity as well as debt. Could NSE help a researcher providing tick by tick data? Commodity derivatives. Okay, so basically, we are in the process of setting up a data room, which should be available in the next 2 to 3 months period. Idea is to try and allow in researchers to, you need to give what exactly is your area of research, what exactly you want to do. And based on that, we make available data. And you can actually do it. Even today, we give data to researchers, both commodities as well as all asset classes. Researchers can take the data and then work on it. But we are making life far more simple using a data room. You don't have to pull the data because tick by tick data is huge. Our data per day runs into a couple of terabytes. So it's impossible for a researcher to manage the data offline. So we are creating a data room that will help people to manage, do your research on our servers and then take the output and then take it away and complete your research. So this should be available in the next maybe 2 to 3 months period. Be in touch with us. We will announce it on our website. And the question is, when do you expect managers to initiate a share repurchase? Okay, so that depends on company policies. I'm not the person, right person to talk about it. Can you elaborate how one, as a retail investor, prevents situation as Vedanta delisting? Well, delisting is a process. There are companies, management, which are trying to go private. There are a process which has been put in place by SEBI. A delisting process which needs to be followed on a regular basis. So it is important for you to follow the delisting process. A lot of thought has gone into this. So the process needs to be followed. And an individual investor, a set of investors could possibly be able to stop a company from going through a delisting, but it's a set process, which is a set guidelines which have been issued by SEBI. There's another question. Is there any difference between stringency of norms which allow a company to raise funds through corporate bond market, through equity market, for example, in terms of... So, when we allow a company to issue capital, there is obviously a set of ICDR guidelines have to be followed. Similarly, there are bond raising for bond raising also a set of requirements which are put in place. So there are public issue markets and private issue markets. Public issue markets obviously go through almost as stringent requirements as equity markets. Private placement of bonds possible where they place it with institutional investors. So there are differences in the way it works, but there are corporate bonds, highly rated corporate bonds are available, which do give a decent return for investors. And as I said, risk-averse investors can go to government bonds every week. As I mentioned, Reserve Bank of India comes with an auction schedule, and investors can participate in the auction and then acquire bonds.
Thank you, sir.
That's about as far as the questions are concerned. If there are no questions, I can possibly stop here.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the webinar.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone, for attending.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.